You just witnessed a masterpiece. In my opinion, a masterpiece. Am I right? And it's great for me to be here. This is really an honour. But honestly, I think this film is an extraordinary achievement. And it's been nominated for 7 Oscars, for 7 BAFTAs. But I think most pertinent tonight for 2 Screen Actors Guild Awards for Best Actor and Best Actress. I have a few notes, but I'm just going to put them aside because we're just all actors here. And I think, Carey and Bradley, you've achieved something not only in this film but in your careers, something so extraordinary. I think you're 2 of the best actors working today. And, yeah. And I know you both well enough to know how humble you are, but I think it'd be really great, Bradley. I've known you for many years and I've been through this process with you, and I saw early screen tests with Carey 4 years ago, it was, I think, that first screen test that you did. And it's been 6 years for you, Bradley, right, with the film? And so I know a lot of the ins and outs, and I just am dying for you guys to hear some of it, because I think, as we know, as actors, there's so much work that goes involved to make something look so effortless and something so transformative. And if it's okay with you guys, I'd like to just look under the hood a little bit. And I'd love you to talk about your process a little bit. And I'm going to start with you, Carey. And I think it's pertinent also to say that not only are you 2 of the great screen actors alive, you're both incredible stage actors as well. And if I could gush for a little bit, Carey, because Bill Nye to me is in top 3 stage actors of all time that I've ever seen. And so when I saw you in Skylight, I was like, yeah. Oh my God, how do you match Bill Nye? But Carey Mulligan, not only match, you're extraordinary in that. And so you're playing Felicia, you're playing her over, how long is it? Is it 4 decades?
Yeah, 25 to 57, yeah.
Okay, so for over 30 years. I'd love for you to maybe illuminate a little bit on what parts of her character do you feel were constant through that and which parts evolved?
Oh, that's such a good question. Hi, everyone. This is so nice. This is so cool, Hugh Jackman's doing this. I just said it's so unbelievably cool that Hugh Jackman is doing. I mean, like,
can't... It's a big one, Yeah.
Can't be not playing that cool. That's such an interesting question, because I do think she went on a huge journey. And I think when we were so lucky, because we had these amazing tapes of them being interviewed and also of them just being. So there was this writer, John Groom, went and wrote a book called The Private World of Leonard Bernstein. And we had these tapes, these original recordings that he wrote his book on. And you could hear them being interviewed about their lives. But also there was an amazing... dinner that he put his tape recorder in the middle of the table at dinner in Italy on holiday in 1967 and pressed record, and it was just them telling the story of when they got married and how it was just complete calamity and everyone got really drunk and took pills and and it was all, and there was just tons of, you know, sort of capers. Anyway, so you could hear them just completely being themselves, but you could also hear them being interviewed. And I think what I was struck by was just how wry she was, how she held herself, how held. There was this sort of, she was always sort of, there was a poise to her and an elegance that sort of went into everything. And she was very, she knew her mind on things. And I think that was a constant in her life. I think she always knew exactly how she felt about things outside of herself. But I think there was an element of sort of self-protection and self-delusion that kind of fueled her through her relationship. But when I wanted to play her and we had talked, I wanted to go back to where she came from, because she left, you know, her father was American, but she grew up in Santiago, Chile, and spent lots of time coming to America. But she made the choice to move to New York as a very young woman, and I thought, what an extraordinarily courageous thing to do. And so she had that amazing courage. So there were just so many facets of her personality that I think I could have just kept learning about her forever.
The tapes, how often did you listen to them?
Oh, every day for I mean, every day, constantly, all the time. And we did that, you know, we had this incredible dialect coach, Tim Monick, and we would play them and listen to him. Have you worked with Tim?
I have, yeah.
Just the best, best. And so we would listen to them and you know, work on them. And then I would just, we'd just have them on our phones in our heads all the time. And they were amazing.
While we're on Tim Monick, Bradley, I remember hanging out with you one day. You said, oh, I'm going to work with Tim. And I said, weren't you working with him last week? And you said, oh, no, he's been here for months. So Bradley had him. How long was he with
it's
you?
Embarrassing.
It's not embarrassing.
Too long.
No, because this is what it takes to do what you did.
We started when I was still finishing A Star Is Born. So we started in L.A. And I remember you came,
I
actually.
I came over because I was there for Wildlife. Not for the Oscars, but you know, the Independent Spirit Awards. But we went over, I went over to the house, and it was Oscars weekend, and Tim Monick was there, and they were working on Lenny.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was just lucky that he was willing to do that, and then we worked in New York. But you know, Lenny had five different voices, really, or three, or two, and then we split it up into two, really, kind of, for the movie. But just as he aged, his voice went down an octave because of smoking and a deviated septum and all of the way he lived. He was an insomniac and he had asthma. And there's all this, there's a great audio of him leaving this message for Jerome Robbins that we put basically verbatim in the movie. And that was a wonderful template for young Lenny at 25. And then obviously there's so much recordings of him talking when he was 50 and then as he got older, when he was in his late 60s to 72. So we just had these wonderful pieces of primary source material, and the voice, to me, in terms of acting, is always the key. We've talked about this, you know. When I first started acting, all I wanted to do was, like, can I just be real on stage or in front of the camera? Can I just be me in the voice that I'm talking to you right now? Because, you know, in auditions, I don't know about you, but I'd leave an audition and my voice would be hoarse because I was so not connected to what I was doing. You know, and it's like a screaming scene or whatever. And I realized, like, oh, I've got to get in touch. But then because I had the privilege of working for over a long period of time, I started to get more bolder in the, wow, yeah, we're getting married. And that was good. Yeah, it's like, not like, it's great. That's an aha moment. Yeah, yeah, as I got older. Yes, ma'am, I am getting older. And so I started to, I remember Willem Dafoe came to our school and he was asked what roles he chooses. And he says, I only choose something that scares me. And I thought at the time, well, I'll never do that because I only want to do something that I think I could possibly do. But now it's all about doing something that's absolutely terrifying, but you feel maybe deep down there's a place for you to connect with that character. And the voice for me has always been, in the latter half of my career, the key. It started with American Sniper. That was the first time I worked with Tim, and then A Star Is Born, A Nightmare Alley, and then this movie. So that's where a lot of the work, but more than just the work, the thing that gets us through, I think, and all the people that were involved in the movie is enthusiasm and joy. That's really it. I mean, I feel like it was the same exact experience that I had in grad school with my friends working on Lie of the Mind or Hurley Burley. It was that same, just, that's all we wanted to do was work on it and do ridiculous things to, like, get into character and, you know, experiment. And I don't know about you, but it always felt like, you know, our parents aren't around, so we could do whatever. That's the thing about being able to direct it. You're like, there's nobody behind us. Right. It's just us. We can do whatever the fuck we want.
Do you remember the moment when you were like, oh, the voice, I've got it. It's just in my bones. Do you remember that for both of you?
It was after a long, long time.
Yeah,
and it was older Lenny came first, and then younger Lenny came second. Yeah, because it was trying to figure out creatively where younger Lenny would fit. And Carey was a huge part of ensuring that I felt, because it was high-pitched. I was like, this is ridiculous. But you were like, but I did feel real. It was organic. I felt that was the voice.
Right.
Based on that tape, and we carried that over to when he was a little bit older. Yeah, I would say it probably happened 6 months before we started shooting.
Right.
Which was years after. And there's a lot of like, oh, this is horrible. Yeah.
Right.
I would call her often as Lenny and many of my other friends. Yeah, yeah.
And they're like,
no, you don't have it. Nowhere close. Are you sick? What's going on?
Yeah. I'm also fascinated, as I'm sure everyone else is, about the physicality of both of the characters. Carey, I'd love for you to talk about that elegance about her. I'd love you to talk about finding the physicality of her and maybe talking a little bit about the latter years with the illness and how you prepared for that.
Yeah, it was I think because we'd spent so much time feeling like we kind of lived with these people, you know, we listened to them all the time, we read everything we could about them, we looked at all the photographs, we talked to the kids so much, Jamie, Alexander, and Nina, the Bernstein kids, who were just amazing. They just gave us so much access. So I felt like we'd spent so much time with them oddly, but there was a part of me that thought, I've never played a character over this span of time. I'm going to have to make some sort of graph to figure out where, you know what I mean? Like people, the guy who was in All Quiet on the Western Front did you read about that? He made a graph of where he would be physically and emotionally because they were jumping all over the place and he had to remember what injuries he had. And I thought, oh, maybe I'll have to do something like that but actually I think because we had spent so much time with these characters, I was tracking where Felicia was by Bradley. Like there was a, when I looked into a young Lenny, I felt young, you know, and when I was unwell, Bradley as Lenny and everyone around me on set was treating me like I was very unwell. So there was I think the way that Bradley constructed it and the way that the set felt and the way the crew were invested, I didn't have to, there was a lot of it that was just instinctive because of the way that I would be treated on set or where I would see my husband or my, you know, and that was informing a lot of it. So it wasn't something that I wasn't sort of enormously conscious of.
Bradley, talk about the conducting. I know you wanted to be a conductor from a kid, right? And so in some ways this must have been literally like your inner kid's dream to play this. But we talked about it a lot. I'd love for you to illuminate a little more about that process of learning to conduct and learning to conduct like Lenny.
Well, it was more, at first it was just about, yeah, always loving conducting, but like Bugs Bunny, you know, Tom and Jerry conducting when I was a kid, you know, those wonderful cartoons, you know. I think I'm one of like, you know, millions of kids that did that, I'm sure. And then in terms of this movie, knowing that we had learned on A Star Is Born that if you record the vocals live, it's pretty invaluable story-wise, and that was the same thing that we brought to this movie for the conducting, that one scene in the church that we had to, I knew that for us, hopefully you as an audience, would understand what she's experiencing. So that was the goal. And I didn't know any other better way to do it than if we actually did it, so we're capturing it. Now, the London Symphony Orchestra certainly did not need me there to do it at all. So, but the thing I was trying to achieve desperately, and what you could see on YouTube from the 73 performers, is just the utter joy that Lenny had at communicating with the orchestra. And I spent so many moments with the New York Phil and the Los Angeles also with Gustavo Dudamel, and then in Philadelphia with Yannick Seguin and Yap here at the New York Phil. They opened their doors to me, so I was always able to go and watch for the last, you know, several years. And there was just this incredible thing where I would sit in the wings where you could, everything's in profile, and it almost looked like a sound wave. The movement of those conductors with the orchestra, and that's what we have to get, and then that matched with joy. So it's just one element. So that was the thing about it. I wasn't ever trying to mimic him because I knew that would be a fool's errand. But can I somehow inherently believe that I'm him doing it? Do it live with this orchestra and communicate with them and communicate just that. That fearless joy, you know. So when I watched it back, I was like, I didn't realize my mouth was open that big the whole time. I was like, but we only did it once, so we don't have the budget to digitally close my mouth. So, but there was something, you know, it felt very naked, you know, very naked, and but it was beautiful, and I felt like that's what it needed. That scene needed to have that. It was just unequivocal that he's joyful in that moment, especially coming off of. The Thanksgiving fight, where she says all it is hate that drives him.
I want to get back to that scene. I'm sure everyone wants to hear about it. And so maybe teeing up to some individual scenes I'd love to ask you guys about. How did you create this? I mean, this is an epic love story, ultimately. So how, before filming, did you work to create that, dynamic and to explore it? I guess I'm asking you as actors, but also as a director, how did that happen?
Well, we all know, you and I have both worked with Elizabeth Kemp, who has passed away, but I learned from her this dream workshop in grad school that I found invaluable and that I'd always done on my own for movies, and then I started to do with the other actor once I started to direct movies. So Stephanie, Lady Gaga, was the first person, and it really did bond us in a way that made the movie possible, I thought. And then, so I knew right away, and I spoke to Carey about it early on, and Elizabeth had passed away, but your teacher, Kim, what's her last name?
Kim Gilliam.
Gilliam, yeah. Yes, Kim Gilliam, who's fantastic, had done Dream Workshop with Sandra Seacat, so they all had sort of funneled from the same place. And we spent 6 days. I think that was the cornerstone of our connection, because we'd always known each other. And it was so wonderful to have Carey during the writing process of the movie, because we would read scenes. But it wasn't until we did that. Certainly, I didn't feel like completely free with Carey until we had finished that, because I had certainly never explored creatively in ways that I would, you know, if you told me that 10 years ago. The expressions that you witnessed, I don't think I would ever say I would be possible to do that.
Yeah.
Without giving anything away.
Yeah. Well, we had a thing that we were like, we did it in Bradley's loft, and we were like, what happens in the loft?
Stays
in the loft. Yeah. It was intense.
So in broad strokes, in those 6 days, are you a mixture of you guys as well as the characters, or is there some point you just sort of drift off into the characters? How does it work?
Yeah, it was really a mixture. It was a lot of you know, it's talking about your dreams, and so there's, so you know, it's your subconscious, it's connecting your subconscious to the work, and within that there's so much personal stuff, but there's also things that you do discover about Lenny and Felicia, and particularly about their connection. And
it's active. You're doing exercises like loss and betrayal as an adult and a child, as yourself and the characters, and then it ends in a ritual that you perform for the other person, like a 20-minute thing that you create, and it's usually to music, and there's props and a costume or whatever you want to do, and that's sort of the final element of this gift you're giving to the other person and to the work.
Yeah, but the day before that we went up to Fairfield.
We did.
Yeah, we went to the house, which is in the film, which is their house that they still live in, or, you know, and we went and we spent the day there and we worked there. We did the same work, but we did it in their house. And then Kim was like, now just go around the house, and you're Lenny and Felicia, and just go and do some. So we just wandered around the house for a couple of hours, and we found ourselves chatting in the living room, but we were them, and it was. And it was, I mean, I'm English, I've never done anything like this before. before I was like, oh God, this is going to be, but it's mad, you just find yourself, I was like, I get to work with Bradley Cooper, I get to act with him, I get to be directed by him, like, I'll do whatever. I was scared shitless, but actually, It was just made the world of difference in so many ways.
I have worked in the past with Elizabeth and done that work myself as Logan, as lots of characters. I've never done it with another actor, but you can feel it. You can see it. You can feel it leap off the screen. Okay, there's so many scenes I want to go to, but one of the first ones that comes to mind is the post-makeout scene, that first scene with your feet up on the bed. And you're lying because you got the bad back. And I remember you, I think we were caught up on the weekend just after you'd finished shooting that scene. You said it sort of went differently. So explain a scene like that. How much of that is scripted? How much of that is ad-libbed? How much of that do you know as a filmmaker how you're going to shoot it, or how much it is on the fly on the day?
It's a great question, because the thing that I really learned as an actor, all we want to be is calm, right, and open and relaxed. And I realized that even as a writer and a film and a director, it's the same principle. And because this incredible actress who has put in all the work and is Felicia on set, I mean, it's just she is her, that's who it is. We had a wonderful scene, but right before I said I'm going to make, I was thinking about it. I'm also in the makeup chair like 4 hours before crew call, so a lot happens in that time. I changed a lot of stuff because I'm playing through. I was like, oh, we should be, because the whole thing, there was so much joy, and they always played games, and I was worried that this one scene that we wrote wasn't going to make it, and it didn't make it in, so I wanted to make sure there were games. So I asked you to play a game when we sat, and that number game came from Carey. And then this idea of how is he going to, I was always going to say that thing about my father in that scene, but I thought, how can we get to it? You know, and the best way for him to get to it is a game, you know, Envy and Secrets. So I just made up this game that she wasn't aware of, you know, on the day as we're sitting there. Because I always knew I was going to try to do it, you know, one shot coming over, which was always going to be, the transition from the dance scene, you know, with the sheet and them, and then you go over the feet, you're there, and then hopefully just at the end, two cameras covering them, and then we're out.
Right.
So I knew that we had, and because also she's so incredible about rhythm, that we could talk to each other and I could stay in the shot because it's alive, like in theater. Yeah. And that just, it lends a level of reality for us. You know, like I actually asked on her, and I knew I could ask her if I asked on her, and she wouldn't say, well, what, that's not the line.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? That instead, right. In fact, it's just immerse ourselves even more deeply into the moment. And then it's really thrilling because you've created this structural, the confines cinematically, and then you're like letting these people, human beings, characters, they'll just free within this structure, and that's what I find the most exciting.
I keep forgetting you also had hours of prosthetics every day. It's sort of amazing. Kerry, it must have been so unusual to see a man in the makeup chair hours before you. It must have been great.
He also, it takes that long for him to get ready before and then to be there for crew call. But then right. At the end of the day, it's another hour and a half to take it off.
Right.
You know, yeah.
And Kerry, for you, if you wouldn't mind, I really would love to talk about the Thanksgiving scene, which my friend directed the movie told me it was the third take, right?
Yeah.
The third take in the wide shot, but that you had not planned to do any coverage. That was the plan?
That was the dream.
Okay, got it.
Yeah, I didn't know if we could pull it off, but because there were two things I was hoping we could do, which was, you know, make the whole scene, the punchline be Snoopy, you know, if we could do it.
Yes.
And the joke works best if you stay in that shot.
Yes.
And then luckily, that was an example of the day, I was like, we need a setup for the joke. And Snoopy was, you know, set deck had the Snoopy. I was like, oh, that's it. You know, he's upset because he wanted to hopefully connect Lenny to Snoopy. But then I had like in my head, we were going to set up two shots to do coverage if everything failed. But, you know, again, she drives the whole scene, as you saw. And because of that, that's the only reason we were able to stay in that wide shot, was because the actor was able to just blaze through a four-page scene effortlessly, and next thing you know, the scene's over. And there's no need to do it, because the emotion's so true.
Yeah.
It could be the way I was with my sister and my parents fought as a kid. That was the genesis of that scene. I was always most scared being far away listening to a fight. If I'm in the middle, I wasn't in the middle, you know, looking at my mom in a close-up and then my dad. That I felt like if I did that for you, you would feel safe and know it's a movie. But if I put you where I was, at least as a kid, that didn't feel safe to me. And that was the hope.
Kerry, yeah.
Yeah.
Kerry, for you, there must be one of those scenes, as you said, the character so poised, and here you could feel the years, the decades of frustration of unsaid things, and out it all came. It was extraordinary. I want to hear from you how that day went, how you felt, how much anticipation you had for the scene, probably from the moment you read it, up to that. And at the same time, I want to protect you if it exists and you don't want to talk through your process. But I think as an actor, I'm fascinated by how you managed to traverse that day and that scene so brilliantly.
Oh, thank you. That's so nice. I mean, the first thing is that I got this incredible piece of writing, you know, which was the first thing that Bradley ever sent to me.
Yeah.
So I think the first thing he wrote for the whole movie was that. So I got that in like the end of 2018.
Yeah.
So I had this, and he'd screenshotted his computer and texted it to me. And I was putting my kids in the bath, and I was like, oh my God, this is so good.
Yeah.
It's such an incredible piece of writing. And so I was so excited, and we had read it a million times. Every time we'd read the script together, but we'd also tested it when we did a big camera test. So it felt like we had those words just right at the tip of our tongue, and so I don't know if I enormously. It was the last thing we shot in New York in that main chunk of shooting, But I don't think I built it up any more than any other scene, except that I was excited to do it because it's such brilliant writing. And I also, we had shot almost the entire film, so I'd lived all the things that were fueling that anger, you know. And it was just, it was just a blast. It's the best thing in the world when the camera's like there and you don't have to, you know, especially when you've done theatre, you're like, oh, great. Yeah. There's no one's filming us. And Kevin Thompson, our production designer, had made this incredible set. And we did the first two takes, which were a different version of that scene, but just weren't where it was. And then this is what Bradley would do the whole way through the shoot, is that he would note, there would be notes, but not really. It would be more subtle than that and more kind of holistic. He would change what Lenny was doing to make me change what I was doing. So his performance he'd alter his performance to make my performance different. So on that third take, everything about what, so he says I drive the scene and I shout a lot, but what Bradley did as Lenny informed everything that I did. So every, you know, when I remember that he like walked in with the sunglasses on holding a carton of milk. And I went, oh. And he bumped into the sofa, and I was like, you fucking bumped into the sofa. And just like everything he did in that take just took it to the next level of like, and I was like, oh, now we're going to fight. And then we did, and we had this enormous fight, and it was just kind of brilliant. I loved it.
What is it like? Yeah. After this, I have one more question. So, but I would love to know what it's like being directed by your co-star.
The best. I mean, the best. I mean, I don't know, but in general, maybe it's awful. But for me, it was the best. It was because it wasn't. There was no separate hats being worn. He had done the work, and also he is talented enough as an actor to pull it off. That's the other part of it. Like, you can prep as much as you like, but his innate, I mean, we were at this Santa Barbara thing the other day and they showed clips from Bradley's career, and I literally just wanted to watch all of those films again. Like, his every time you work, it's just.
I agree.
So just that, you know, it makes your job so much easier when you just look into the other person and you're like, I believe every single thing you're doing. I don't need to do anything. And that's what he did, and then directed it all.
I think you said it perfectly. It's what I've always seen in your work, in both of your work, actually. There's just a level of truth that is undeniable from the moment you're on screen. And it's I think, actually, the demand for truth and your love of the truth. I know Bradley really well, and I don't know you as well, but I feel just from watching your work that you have that sense in your life as well, both of you, that love for the truth, and that your search through acting is actually for that truth. So I kind of want to finish with a question that it comes from having worked with Elizabeth Kemp, who did some of these dream workshops and with me, and she would always sort of open the invitation to you as an actor to ask the character to almost meld with your spirit, with your psyche. And so I'm wondering what each of you have learned from Felicia or Lenny that you take away in your life.
Be bold. Yeah, it was impossible not to be... it's funny you say that about acting, because this experience, the only other time I really had, there were moments in American Sniper where I just felt like I was not there at all, and I had just opened it up enough for Chris to come in, Chris Kyle, who was based on a real person. But not since The Elephant Man. I did feel that on The Elephant Man for Joseph Merrick, but it was different because it was a play. But I really didn't feel like, because there was that moment every morning. The truth is that makeup time, that prep before crew call was a blessing for an actor, an absolute blessing. And it was that moment of hours of stillness as this physical thing is being put on, this costume, this thing, this shell. And then there was a moment where I then had to take that leap of faith, which was guided by the voice as the key. I would go in behind the curtain, get dressed, and then come back for them to put the sort of, if it was a half a wig or eyebrows on. But I always made the choice to jump off the cliff in that moment and for Kazuhiro to be Lenny, because I was going to have to be Lenny the rest of the day directing the movie. And that leap felt like me letting something in, not me acting. And I was terrified every day of the 54 days whether he would come in. That's what, and I would even say to her, like, I hope he comes today because we're fucked. You know, like, fucked. Because if I'm thinking about, like, what I'm doing as an actor, the whole machine's going to break down, right? And he came in, and because he came in all of those days, and especially that last take in Ely Cathedral, because he wasn't there the first day. That was the only day where he wasn't there, because I was just so riddled with fear and tense, and I wasn't open. Because I was scared of making a fool out of myself. And the only way I know how to act the best one can is if you just have to absolutely be willing to make a fool out of yourself. And so what he taught me and what the experience taught me more than just him, working with Carey, the crew, this film as a lived experience was just keep being bold. That's it. And then if you look at Lenny, that's clearly how he created and lived in so many ways.
Mm-hmm. Well, being bold is what you've both done in this film. It's clear, it's obvious, and you've been bold in your careers, in your choices. It feels odd for me to say I feel proud. I mean, not for you, Bradley, because we're such good mates. I'm incredibly proud of what you've achieved as a director in this film, as a producer, as a writer. But for both of you, your acting is extraordinary. It's an inspiration to all of us in this room and anyone watching. It's just a level of craft. And so, yeah, congratulations.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks for staying around. Thanks.